Hi, I'm Richard Schwartz, President Emeritus of Jewish Veg, and the author of, most recently, Vegan Revolution, Saving Our World, Revitalizing Judaism. And I want to welcome you to this wonderful panel on Can a Climate Catastrophe Be Prevented? And we have an incredible panel, really excellent people on that. And I set it up so people will be speaking alphabetically, each one for about 5 or 6 minutes. And I was gonna go last, but this is the first time I'm presenting a PowerPoint. I've been working with excellent host here, David Kranz. So I'm gonna really start the PowerPoint now, because later on I might need to do it. But everybody will have a chance on this. Okay, so here it is. Can a climate catastrophe be prevented? Most important issue of today. And just to give a little bit of background, I already mentioned that President Emeritus of Jewish Veg and on the board working on this for about 40 years or so. And again, this is a book, by the way, that I'm willing to give away PDFs freely of the picture and the cover and the complete text of that book. Okay, so just getting into the issues. This is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the most important group on the issue with scientists, climate experts from many countries. And they indicated in 2018 that we needed what they called unprecedented changes by 2030 in order to have a chance to avert a climate catastrophe. Unfortunately, 4 years later, found out that atmospheric carbon dioxide had reached record levels. So really need changes, we're heading in the wrong direction. And because of that, the UN Secretary General indicated, this is a code red for humanity. Delay means death, we really have to move along. And there's a very strong scientific consensus. 97% of climate experts, all major science academies worldwide, thousands of peer-reviewed articles in respected scientific journals, all agreeing climate change is a big threat, human-induced for the most part, and that major changes have to soon occur. And here is the thing you can see on this graph. Temperature has been going up every decade since the 70s. It's a little bit over 1 degrees Celsius now since the beginning of the industrial age. And later on, we're gonna see the projections are for increase quite a bit. And I've mentioned some of these points. So what is happening out there? And we've seen that especially this summer, unprecedented, often record-breaking via climate effects, glaciers melting, polar ice caps melting, polar bear and many other animals, danger of extinction. And already there's sunny day flooding in coastal cities like Miami, Florida. The seas have risen only about an average of about 8 inches, but much more is expected, especially if that melting occurs. And additional melting, very dangerous to permafrost. And why that's so dangerous is that there's methane, other very potent greenhouse gases below. If anybody had signed in a little late, I was gonna speak later alphabetically, but working with David Kranz, our wonderful host, helping me, this is the first time I've done a PowerPoint. So while I had it set, I wanted to get it started on this. Okay, so Greenland is melting, and that if that continues melting, that could raise the seas quite a bit. And you can see from the right picture of Greenland to the left, even in a 4-year period, how much more is melting. And we saw that this year, London, first time over 40 degrees Celsius, the heat waves are increasing, droughts all over, incredible, so much in the US West, tremendous droughts in China, so severe that the hydroelectric plants are not functioning, and unfortunately they have to move back toward coal. Wildfires are increasing, especially in California because of the dry conditions and the heat waves. Of course, the storms are increasing, 3 major reasons. The seas are higher. We mentioned that 8 inches, gonna be a lot more. The water is hotter, it gives more energy to the storms as they go approach the land, and more moisture so that we have more severe storms when they occur. Floods are increasing, and amazing thing, one third of Pakistan under flood, and it may be months and months before they get back to normal. Four reasons why things are likely to get far, far worse. They're indicated here, but the next slides tell more about it, so just go into that. Notice on the left, way down toward the bottom, 1 degree, that's about where we are now, but they're hoping to go no more than 1.5 degrees Celsius, but looks like that may happen within just a couple of decades. 2 degrees Celsius even, but notice as way over to the right, 2100, it could be far, far, far higher. And when you think of the very negative effects or severe storms and other climate effects at 1 degree Celsius, imagine 3, 4, 5, it really could be an uninhabitable world, the world. Okay, and this is extremely important, the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The climate experts think that 350 parts per million, that is like a threshold value. Well, we hit that many years ago. This year it hit 420, increasing at 2 or 3 parts per million per year. So these are the things. And climate refugees, the Pentagon, other military groups think that there can be tens of millions. Climate refugees, that makes terrorism, war, instability far more likely. And already there were civil wars in Sudan and Syria because of drought that caused many climate refugees. Okay, forest fires. So this is another very important thing. That is that there could be what they call self-reinforcing positive feedback loops that could reach a climate tipping point with things being out of control. So I give an example here, the many, many wildfires we mentioned. Of course, with the trees are destroyed, they're no longer absorbing carbon dioxide, and they're giving off the carbon within them, and there'll be a lot of energy needed. So many homes are destroyed, so many factories, and so many cars. So this is also is an example of that positive feedback loop that only when the sun's rays hit the ice and snow, only 10% is absorbed as heat, 90% is reflected back out in space. But once that melts, the darker water and the darker land, that does not reflect the same amount, then 94% is absorbed. So you can see that that means more melting, and that means more energy of the sun absorbed. So that's the vicious cycle that can make a big, big difference. This is just another example of that, showing the high reflectivity of the ice and the very low reflectivity of the water. And just to give an example, this is one of the recent stories in the Jerusalem Post, and show the whole world, the Middle East is being hit harder. And they mentioned that it could be as much as 5 degrees Celsius increase in Israel and other Mideast countries by the end of the century. Well, the experts talk about zero emissions, and it is good news that solar energy has gone down in price, part of the solution, wind power. But as many of the speakers have indicated, the elephant in the room is being overlooked, or more relevantly, the calendar room. And this is one of our speakers' books, and we have 3 speakers with very excellent books on this. And that really educated me more and more on the need for a shift to plant-based diets to have a chance to avert a climate catastrophe. Because as Glen Merzer points out, and Salesh Rao, people who are gonna be speaking a little bit later, vast areas are now used for grazing and growing feed crops for animals. If that could be reforested, that could make a major difference. But here are just a couple of quick pictures, trees being cut down, forests being burned, and the older trees especially being destroyed. And this is the amazing thing. It's like the world's committing suicide. We need to plant more trees. And the deforestation in Brazil's Amazon, the highest in 12 years. You know, every year trees are being destroyed rather than enough being planted. Another one of our speakers, Salesh Rao, and based on the analysis, not only will planting of trees, more reforestation, reduce that very deadly gas methane, about 80 times as potent as carbon dioxide and heat in the atmosphere, but that will permit the reforestation of those vast areas I mentioned used for grazing and growing food crops. And his analysis, which I'm sure we'll be talking about a little bit later, is at least 87% of greenhouse gases are related to animal agriculture. So I've been blessed with five great-grandchildren. In 6 years, I've moved to Israel. So the question is, what kind of world are we leaving them? We have a choice between a mainly vegan world and a destroyed really world. Give peas a chance, we're saying. And just putting final slides here. We need to have success because there's no planet B, there's no effective plan B. So that's basically it. I hope I didn't go too much over the time. And I'm sure, as I said, we have this super excellent panel that will, they will build on this and I'm sure add many, many important facts. So with that in mind, I'm going to stop to share. I hope that works out. And start to introduce a wonderful, wonderful panel. I apologize to them because time limitations, they can only permit 5 or 6 minutes, hopefully. Each one can talk for hours on these topics. And I'm hoping maybe to set up podcasts and interview any of them. So our first speaker is a vegan Rabbi Akiva Gersh. And I've had the pleasure of taking his course, a succession course, hearing him speak many times, including at a major veg festival, very creative. He just started a dating service and is setting up tours, vegan and sustainable tours in Israel. So, Akiva, you are our next speaker.
Thank you, Richard, for the introduction and for inviting me to take part in this incredible panel. My name is, first of all, Richard, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I'm hearing you fine. Hope the others can as well. And let's see, I want to get out of this. Yeah, we're hearing you and I see you now. So you can start speaking.
Okay, there, which is the Sea of Galilee, Egypt with friends, and it coincided with this really important panel, and I didn't want to miss it. So here I am sitting outside.
Somehow,
and taking part in sharing. So really good to be here. Just want to share climate change. Are you able to hear me okay?
Yeah, we're hearing you.
Okay, great. Okay. So Judaism, veganism, and climate change really intertwined all three of them. You know, I was thinking that it's so interesting in the first chapter of Genesis, chapter one, we sing line where basically it seems that God is telling humans right after they're created, you know, take over the world, you know, populate it, you know, rule it. You know, even subdue it, the chivshuha, as we say in Hebrew. And it's a little startling to your modern day environmentalist. But then the very next verse 29 in chapter one of Genesis tells the humans that sets a completely vegan diet. And so many commentators have talked about these two verses. And Rav Kook, who was the first chief rabbi of pre-state Israel, lived from 1865 to 1935, said about this word, this use of the word dominion, saying can we imagine that an all-loving God would think of dominion in any kind of harsh and totalitarian kind of way, you know, the rule of a harsh and cruel and to do something she could do. And in chapter 1 of Genesis, where humans are told, oh, by the way, this dominion, you know, that you just heard about, in terms of food, you can't kill animals. You can't use animals. You can't raise animals for food. They're not part of your diet. And it already shows the humans, the early humans, the limitations that come with being in the world. And again, with the responsibilities. All right, so again, I think there's a deeper level of connection between these two verses, because God did give us special abilities, and God gave us free choice how to use those special abilities. And we can use those special abilities and those special strengths for good or, unfortunately, for the opposite. And we know throughout human history, many humans and many generations have done incredible things for the world, but unfortunately, we know the opposite is true as well. And specifically in our modern day age, we are getting used to using our special role in creation in order to wreak havoc and create destruction and to destroy what has been in the world for a long, long time. And the fact that these two verses are right next to each other, for me, sends a very strong message that how do we frame our special role in creation in a proper way? How do we use our special abilities and strengths in the proper way? Is to how we eat. That there's a very deep connection to between how we eat and how we impact the world. And we know that today, that the way we eat is literally destroying the world. Right? It's obviously not only killing animals, billions, tens of billions of them every single year, but it is causing them to lead lives of pain and suffering from the moment that they are born into this world and until the moment that they're killed. Right? So there's the suffering to animals. There's the pollution that it causes. All these things that everyone knows. Right? The negative impact on the environment today, right, due directly to how we eat, the food choices that we as humans are making, destroying the world. And when we go into the books of Judaism, and when we go into the texts of the Jewish tradition, we see tons and tons of teachings that talk about responsibility towards our own health, responsibility towards animals and taking care of animals and not causing unnecessary pain and suffering to animals. And if you do see and know about pain and suffering to animals, then doing all you can to alleviate it, not wasting resources, as we call it, bal tashchit. Right? And doing all we can to live lives that are causing more positivity in the world than negativity, creating more than destroying. And when it comes to climate change, we know the facts are out there. We know that there's a direct connection between how we eat and what's happening in the world. And we have the responsibility, a Jewish responsibility, a Torah-based responsibility, to make sure that what we are eating is taking care of our own health, taking care of the animals, and taking care of the planet. And if it's not that way, then we need to make a change. Directive. There's multiple commands telling us to do so. Thank you again, Richard, for inviting me, and kol hakavod for all your incredible work in this important field.
Okay, thank you very much for that wonderful statement. Okay, our next speaker is James Morris Hicks, and he envisions how we might totally reinvent the way we live on this planet, such that we can coexist indefinitely in a virtual paradise with nature. He documents that process in the third book, Outcry, Urgent Alarm from a Planet and What We Can Do About It, published as an ebook only because he doesn't even want the paper to be used for that. And by the way, I heard him talk to a vegetarian group in Hawaii, really super, and I read part of that book, and really inspiring. So many thanks, James, for what you're doing, and we look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you, David. I'm in Vermont today. I have prepared a written statement so I could get get the most out of my 5 minutes. So beginning with my background in the business world, I studied industrial engineering in college, became a process improvement consultant, and later a corporate executive. Throughout my lengthy career, I've always tried to leverage the Pareto principle, better known as the 80-20 rule, striving to focus primarily on the significant few issues of any improvement opportunity rather than on the insignificant many. After becoming curious about the optimal diet for humans in late 2002, I was literally blown away by what I learned about that topic in the first 6 months of 2003. After first learning all about the health promotion, disease reversal powers of whole food, plant-based eating, over Memorial Day weekend, I read two books that focused on the environmental impacts of eating animals. And that's when I had my blinding flash to the obvious, saying to myself, oh my God, we're eating the wrong food for our species. These two books were Diet for a New America by John Robbins and Mad Cowboy by Howard Lyman. That was 19 years ago. Since then, I've leveraged that newfound knowledge coupled with my process improvement background to do everything that I can to help maximize the chances that the children of the world, including my own grandchildren, will have a future. Since 2003, I've gotten to know most of the rock stars in this movement, people like T. Colin Campbell, Dean Ornish, Caldwell Esselstyn, and a few others who are on this panel today, many of whom were gracious enough to endorse my first book, Healthy Eating, Healthy World, in 2011. 4 years later, I teamed up with Cary Graff, MD, to write the Four-Leaf Guide to Vibrant Health. Finally, in 2020, I leveraged my engineering and process improvement background to write Outcry, Urgent Alarms from Our Planet and What We Can Do About Them. To my knowledge, Outcry is the only book ever published that features a summary of the outcries from the natural world, consensus conclusions of 9 big picture scientists about our dilemma, and an envisioned sustainable civilization of the future using today's technology. My latest two books are now being offered for free to the international public. You can find them easily at the landing page of my website at hpjmh.com. Just before my first book was published in 2011, I started a daily blog focused on the many world-changing benefits of whole food plant-based eating. After posting 737 consecutive daily blogs, I started a new generation of shorter bite-sized blogs that I call BSBs in 2016. And most recently in April of 2019, I launched a new weekly series called SOS Memos for Saving Our Species, named after the most recognized distress signal in the world. Earlier this week, I posted SOS Memo number 176, and will probably continue publishing them every Tuesday for the rest of my life as I try to strive to do my part in promoting the complete abolishment of animal meat. Are not going to get it done. What can you do to help? Read the free four-leaf guide and Outcry. Also encourage your friends and family to read them and to join my mailing list at hpjmh.com. Finally, since COVID, I've been offering free Zoom talks to groups of almost any size. Please take me up on that offer. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. By the way, if you want, maybe put that website in the chat so that people can see it. That would be good. Okay, thank you very much. Very good statement. By the way, Gerard Bishop was supposed to also be part of it, and he sends his regrets. Unfortunately, he came down with the flu, and hopefully at another occasion with he would be a very powerful speaker as well. Okay, now I want to welcome Joanne Kong, PhD, as the next speaker. She speaks around the world as an environmental and plant-based nutrition advocate. She's featured in Legends of Change about vegan women changing the world, has been praised for a TED talk. And by the way, I saw that talk and it's really superb. I recommend it to everybody to watch it. And it's entitled The Power of Plant-Based Eating, over a million viewers of that. And she's an editor of another wonderful book called Vegan Voices, Essays by Inspiring Changemakers, and I'm happy I reviewed that book. I forget which publication. I think probably the Jerusalem Report. That's an examination of her own nutrition. And she appears in the major documentary, Eating Our Way to Extinction. That was timing for the previous. And by the way, this came across, I just watched that today, Eating Our Way to Extinction, amazing, very powerful, and I strongly recommend it. So, Joanne, looking forward to your talk.
Thank you, Dr. Schwartz, for this event in which we collectively convey the most important messages that speak directly to this. What is the future of our sustainability on this planet? In order to address the catastrophic impacts of climate change, it is necessary to acknowledge that in the face of these challenges, the very nature of human behavior and perception is a major obstacle. On the whole, humans are reluctant to make changes. There is a tendency for complacency and assumed acceptance of the status quo, a sense of security, stability, even validation comes from continuing the habits we grew up with. This is especially the case with our food habits, for what we eat is a matter of daily choices deeply ingrained in family and cultural traditions. Such cultural inertia touches on all aspects of society, our economic, industrial, energy, and food systems. People easily focus on short-term needs in their lives. The state of climate and the environment is often not at the front of awareness. It's perceived as something distant to people's immediate concerns and something they feel powerless over. And unfortunately, humans don't always take preventive measures. Drastic changes and adaptation may eventually come, but often only as a last resort when there is no choice but to change. So we need to know that with the climate crisis, we've already gone too far into the danger zone. And mainstream media, government, and policy leaders, they remain in a state of disconnection from the central role of animal agriculture in our environmental disasters. They are too easily influenced by the interests of big business, political power, and the economic for-profit mindset. Ignoring how our food systems are wreaking great harm upon us and the natural world, this is the greatest blind spot of our time. We've become conditioned as a society to assume that progress will move us along and that we don't have to worry about the future. But my message today is this: now is the moment. This is the turning point, that proverbial fork in the road. We're facing a clear choice, either to mindlessly continue along the destructive path of animal agriculture, or to seize this time as our point of evolution, one that we can fashion with the best of our qualities, our intelligence, inventiveness, our sense of innovation, courage, perseverance, and optimism. Will we meet this moment, the opportunity to create a new, safer, sustainable, and more compassionate world? Critical transformation is necessary at the larger levels of policy, government, and industry. But such changes are by nature slow to happen. It must also happen at the individual level with every one of you. Never doubt the collective power of all our actions and decisions. To those of you listening to us speaking today, this is your moment. How many times have we heard the statement, "What I choose to eat is a personal choice"? I ask you now to reach deep within yourselves and ask, what can be more personal and consequential then choosing to nourish ourselves in ways that are not only healthy, but that call on us to be at the highest level of our compassionate natures. What can have more impact on a sustainable life than making the honest assessment that a food system relying on animals and animal products is grossly inefficient, has put us out of balance with the natural world, destroys habitats and resources on a massive scale, is a major factor in global disease and rising pandemics, and is unbelievably cruel and violent. We must dare to dream. Dare to dream that we can awaken to a new way of being and living to preserve and protect our planetary home. As scientist E.O. Wilson once said, the world needs all you can give. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the wonderful, wonderful statement. And agree, the time is now. Said that the UN Secretary General said delay is this death and all. So that's why I set this up, and hopefully it's just the beginning. And thanks to David Krantz, it will be recorded, and we'll try to send it out very widely, because this is the issue that, and we've got the answer. We know the threats and all. And by the way, I mentioned your book before, and there's about 50 essays, and really everyone is a gem. And I was so happy to be able to review that book. Okay, so our next speaker is Glen Merzer. And there's another book that I reviewed. I think that was in the Jerusalem Post, Food is Climate, Response to Al Gore, Bill Gates, Paul Hawking, and the Conventional Narrative on Climate Change. And he argues that the only way to reverse climate change is to eliminate animal agriculture, rewild, reforest, the grazing land, and protect the oceans. He's also the author of Own Your Health, an Examination of the Role of Nutrition in Health. And I want to say, I always knew that animal agriculture was a major, major part of the problem. But before I read that book, I never knew how much, and maybe that was the impetus that led to my setting up this Zoom event. So look forward to your talk, Glen.
Thank you, Richard. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you fine. I do.
All right. Well, I see that my dear friend Salesh Rao will be speaking later. And Salesh, of course, wrote the paper that proved that animal agriculture is responsible for at least 87% of greenhouse gases. I tried my best to make his case in my book, Food is Climate. When I learned from you, Richard, that we have 5 minutes to speak, I thought, well, Salesh is a systems engineer. He can speak to all the facts. I am by training a playwright. So I thought I'd try to create a dialogue and see if the creator came back to visit Earth and had 5 minutes to figure out what we're doing wrong. And let's say she met with the head of the UN, some kind of statistician in the UN who knows everything we're doing on the Earth, how that dialogue would go. So the creator would say, you know, I haven't checked in on the Earth for 50,000 years. I was always very proud of the Earth. And I remember I was very proud of you human beings. 50,000 years ago, you were developing very big brains. I predicted big things for you. But I understand there's been a problem. You've been heating up the Earth with greenhouse gases. Now, the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, I remember I created 6 trillion trees that drink carbon dioxide. So what seems to be the problem? Well, we don't have 6 trillion trees anymore. We just have 3 trillion. You misplace 3 trillion trees? How do you do that? Is that because of this coal industry? I heard about the coal industry. Well, the coal industry, hasn't cost us that many trees. Sometimes we dig up a mountain, it doesn't look very nice, and we lose some trees. They usually come back. It's not because of the coal industry. Is it because of the oil industry? Is that what's costing all? No, the oil industry doesn't cost us a lot of trees. Sometimes we have oil spills. We had a terrible spill in the Gulf About 8 years ago, tons of oil pouring into the Gulf. Well, that must have been very bad for the fish, because I remember I created a lot of, well, actually, no, it was good for the fish. When we had the oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico, a lot of the fish came back. Well, I remember when I created fish, they didn't drink oil. Yeah, but the problem is, you see, that the humans stopped fishing because of the oil spill. So that brought back the fish. Wait a minute, I remember I created you in the forest. Aren't you land animals? I remember your cousins were the apes, the chimpanzees, the gorillas. Why do you eat fish? Well, it's part of our culture. It's part of our culture. I don't remember creating culture. No, we created culture. Well, what's the purpose of culture? Well, the purpose of culture is that when we do things that are wrong, we can still be proud of them. So because of the culture, you've been eating fish. What have you done to the ocean? Well, we've destroyed all the oceans because we eat fish. How many of your calories do you get from fish? We get 3% of the fish, 3% of our calories, and we've destroyed all of the oceans for the fish. You've destroyed all the oceans to get 3% of your calories? But I still don't understand what happened to the trees. What happened to the trees? Well, that's because of the cows. I don't remember creating cows. No, you created oxen, but we kind of fatten them up and soften them up and we turn them into cows. So what do you have? You have like hundreds of these cows? No, we have 1.5 billion cows. So how much of the earth do you give to these cows? Well, we give 37% of the earth we've turned over to the cows. And then another 6% we use to grow grain to feed to the cows. So that's 43% of the earth you've created for the cows. That's right. And is that what happened to the trees? Yes, we chopped down the trees and we burned the vegetation because we gave 43% of the earth to the cows. And you do this because of culture? Yeah, we do this because, you know, that's our culture. So I think that the creator in 5 minutes could figure it out, that the greenhouse gas problem, the burning of fossil fuels, is a small part of the problem. The larger part is what we've done to the earth. We've destroyed the oceans because we eat fish. We've destroyed the land. We've chopped down the forest because we eat cows. And these are not our food, as the creator would say, wait a minute, your cousins, the great apes, do they eat fish? Do they eat cows? They don't. So I think it's all very simple. And I think that, you know, until we see the obvious and stop hiding behind culture, we won't solve the problem. Did I do it in 5 minutes?
Yeah, perhaps. Yeah. You could just have another minute or so if you want. That was really super, super, super. By the way, I'd like to encourage you and all the other speakers to, these are such great presentations, to write them up in articles, get them out to the media, and this dialogue with God is really, really tremendous. And you raise the issues so great, as the other speakers have as well. Okay, moving on, we have Camila Perussello. She's also an author of the book that I really love and I reviewed. That's no Food for Thought, Planetary Healing Begins on Our Plate. She's a PhD in food engineering, so she really has a technical background, a science background, published dozens of academic papers and book chapters on food technology and agricultural science. Her research also covers the ethical health environmental implications of our diet. So again, on this super, super panel, we have three authors or editors of wonderful books, and they all have these powerful messages. We have to get them out even more. So Camila, look forward to your talk.
Thank you, Richard, for the introduction and the invitation to. It's really good to be here. I don't know if you can hear me. Yeah, because I'm wearing earphones. Okay. So I think we all agree that these are both difficult and unique times, in the sense that never in our history have we had so many tools to solve the challenges facing the world. But at the same time, we see our problems escalating. It's a real paradox. And this is partly due to science denial. Denialism is somehow understandable because we are all human. So our brain tries to block inconvenient truths. For example, over 97% of climate experts agree that the climate crisis is a ticking bomb, but only 64% of the global population believes it. So we know there are multiple factors driving denialism, for example, political views, educational level, and a whole range of personal interests. But what I want to point out here is, despite our differences, this planet is our only home, and we're all in this together. So the only way to prevent catastrophe is really to have the courage to look the truth in the eye and do whatever we can to translate scientific evidence into action, together for the common good. Now, the mainstream narrative on climate change puts emphasis on fossil fuels while downplays the impact of animal agriculture and fisheries, which not only is a poor reflection of the scientific literature, but it's also reckless. Mounting evidence shows it is impossible not to reach the warming limit of 1.5 degrees Celsius if we don't tackle our food systems. Yes, we do need to change the way we use energy, but also the way we eat. A painful statement for many of us, but true. And now I really want to stress something. The social and environmental costs of animal-centered diets cannot be ignored by a civilized society. Just to name some of these impacts: resource overuse, deforestation, carbon emissions, species extinction, the epidemic of obesity, cancer, and heart disease, antibiotic resistance, animal origin pandemics, needless animal suffering, labor abuse, and so on. It's really an interconnected chain of serious problems arising from the same root. But if we talk exclusively about carbon emissions, even if we stopped burning fossil fuels today, we would still cross critical tipping points. We must move towards plant-based diets to meet climate targets. Just for perspective, in Europe, animal products represent 80% of food carbon emissions, 80%. And on top of that, animal agriculture imports a large percentage of grains from other parts of the world, including the Amazon region. The demand for soybeans, for example, to feed farmed animals in Europe uses 32 million acres just in South America. So a global move to plant-based diets would lower the carbon emissions back to safe limits to give us more time to reassess our energy sources. The diet transition would reduce the area occupied by agriculture by 75%, allowing plant and animal species to recover. And this would also reduce the economic burden of disease and allow us to feed a further 3.5 billion people. It's really a multi-problem solution. So yes, we certainly need governmental aid to do that. But I want to emphasize that consumer choices do make a difference. Studies show that going vegan is the most efficient way to reduce our individual environmental footprint. And what's funny is that many people claim that eating plant-based doesn't matter because their individual consumer choices don't make a difference. But at the same time, the same people support other ways of reducing their individual impact. For example, electric cars. You see, it's denialism again. Of course, consumer choices matter. And my last point is, policymakers and industries have political and economic interests at heart. So if we wait for them to take the first step, it might be too late. But if more and more of us push for system change, for example, through our purchases, the faster governments will act in that direction. And they urgently need to change their priorities to be effective. There is still time to avoid catastrophe, but not much. So I believe my time is up. So I hope this was insightful, and thank you so much.
Well, definitely insightful and very informative. And again, I know you've probably been doing this already, but to get this information into articles, and this is such important information, that hopefully you can get it out. Okay, well, our final speaker is Salesh Rao, and he's the author of a major article that Glen mentioned before that concludes that animal-based agriculture is responsible in effect for at least 87% of greenhouse gas emissions. That's taking into account the potential for planting of trees that could reduce that. Again, we're at 420 parts per million, way over the 350 parts per million that climate experts think is the threshold value. And it's been going up instead of going down. We're committing suicide in this world. Anyway, he speaks often worldwide, and I think he's on a tour recently in India and doing unbelievable, very great things, encouraging the shift to plant-based diets. And part of it is, I know he made a pledge, a commitment to a granddaughter to try to make the world vegan by 2026. And if anybody can do it, it could be him, because he's doing such great work. So Salesh, look forward to your talk.
Thank you, Richard. Can you all hear me okay?
Yeah, we're hearing you.
Okay, perfect. Well, ladies and gentlemen, congratulations. You have heated up the climate of the planet so that the earth can never go back to another ice age again, as long as we are around. So for that, we need to pat ourselves on the back and now ask, what do we do next? We've heated up the climate. Our ancestors did such a great job holding the temperature constant so that we can actually do agriculture. And then over the last 200 years, we discovered fossil fuels and we heated up the climate a little bit more. We increased it by about 1.2 degrees Celsius. And in the process, we created all the tools and technologies we need to understand what we did and now consciously become a climate healing species. Each one of us has a choice to make every day. Do you want to be a climate heater or do you want to be a climate healer? And the difference between the two is actually quite simple. If you are eating animals, you are more likely to be a climate heater. And if you are not eating animals, if you've gone vegan, which means you don't use animals for any purpose whatsoever, you are likely to be a climate healer. So look within yourself and see, do you want to be a climate heater? Do you want to continue to be a climate heater? Or do you want to transform and become a climate healer? Because that is the game plan that nature had put for us. You heated up the climate so that the earth can never go back to the ice age again. And now, if we all go vegan and bring back the forest that we cut, all the fossil fuel-based CO2 will still be up in the atmosphere and the earth will not go back to the ice age again. And so that will keep the temperature at a very balmy level so that all of us can thrive, our children can thrive, the planet can thrive, all the animals can thrive, and we can create a utopia, a Eden, all over again. That's the Eden we had 10,000 years ago when we started on this path. So job well done, ladies and gentlemen, but we do have to take the next step. We don't want to waste 10,000 years of work and then kill ourselves off. That doesn't make any sense. So we need to thank our ancestors. We need to thank all the animals who sacrificed their bodies. We need to thank all the domestic animals who suffered a lot for us to heat up the climate. And need to thank all our fellow humans who also suffered a lot. You know, as we factory farmed our animals, we were also factory farming ourselves. So thank you for all the sacrifice that you did. Now it's time to move on and become a climate healing civilization, a climate healing species. And we can do this. It's not that hard. We have done this before, because all we have to do is to go back to being the way we were 10,000 years ago. It's returning back to our roots. It is coming home to who we are, because in our hearts, we always had compassion for all life. So that is such a beautiful journey back home that we are all taking together. And I am grateful to be here on Earth with you, with all of you, to make this journey happen, because you have been specially chosen to transform civilization from a climate heating civilization to a climate healing civilization. And when we do this, our children and grandchildren are going to look back on this generation and say, they did it. Congratulations for being alive at this time in human history. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I want to thank all the panelists, really. Everyone, great, great statements. And good news is this is going to be recorded and going to try to spread it widely. Of course, the inconvenient truths are the world heading toward climate catastrophe. And we have the solution. If the people are denying it, we have to get that message out. It's incredible what is happening. So we don't have too much time. First, I want to ask if there's anybody who attended this event who would like to make a statement or a comment. We give you a chance now. And otherwise, any of the panelists have any suggestions? We have the answers and all that we've mentioned, and some of you have done a great job. You've written books. How can we break through the apathy, the ignorance, the resistance to get this essential message out? Somehow, we've been trying this for years and years, people still eating meat. And by the way, one fact that wasn't mentioned, I think very, very important, is now there are so many plant-based substitutes. And they say, and this was brought out very well in that movie we mentioned before about we're eating our way to extinction, that longtime meat eaters can't tell the difference between the plant-based substitutes and the animal products. So that if they say, well, I just love the taste too much, you know, I just can't give it up. Well, now they can get that taste without the very negative effects on their own health, on the animals, on the environment. So if you have any suggestions on that, and I'll try, because once the recording is made, I'll send it out to all the speakers, and we'll send it out very widely. And of course, I encourage you also to send that recording out. So I want to keep this within an hour, so we have a few more minutes. If anybody wants to make any final comments, since you were limited to 5-6 minutes. So if there's anything that you think is important that you just didn't have a chance to say, let's see, let us know. If not, we'll wrap it up.
Richard, can I say something?
Sure.
So my name is Nachshon Karmi. I sit in Boca Raton, Florida. I'm a high school teacher. And when I look at the teenagers and the young generation, I think what we need is role models that inspire them. And I think this is our challenge, is changing the ethos of what's rational and what's productive. And I think we need to find a way of recruiting more artists and more athletes because they, I think, are our hope for a different future. I'm just saying this because I feel like I assume that the people here understand the change that we need. And I thank Salish in particular for the term from climate heater to a climate healer. I think that the change of culture has to come as we figure out the levers of culture that are not the political, but the cultural, the people that have a sway with the younger people, because that's where the change will come from. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, we need some role models. And it's great that somebody like Greta Thunberg and some of the young people, you know, the young people seem to be getting it a lot more, thank God. And the word is out. I think more and more people recognize that climate is a problem. By the way, I wrote an article on that this should be a major issue in the midterm elections. And you have two parties here, one in denial about climate change. And it's I think one of the speakers, I just heard this recently, that one out of three people in the US is in an area that's been affected by climate change. So they should recognize, if they want a decent world, they should take this into account and vote for candidates who recognize the threats of climate change and want to do something about it. Okay, so we're sort of at the end of the hour. Once again, be recorded. We'll get this to you and we've got to spread this out. And I hope this will be the beginning. Hope to continue a dialogue with all of you. And again, everyone made a really superb statement. Thank you very much for that. So wishing everybody shalom from Israel and many, many thanks. All the best.
Shana tova, Richard.
Okay. Yeah, the new year for the Jews and hopefully a new beginning. And by the way, I'm giving a talk on Torah portion and in it says, choose life. And the theme I'm going to mention, the importance of choosing life in the world, unfortunately, is choosing death. When we read about the fact that we need to plant so many trees and they're cutting down trees at a record level in the Amazon rainforest. So I'm going to be sending out all kinds of articles and I'll probably send it to you for comments beforehand. Always happy to get good suggestions. So, blessings to everybody and thanks, and we'll be in touch. All the best.